Dark phrases of womanhood, of never having been a girl, half notes scattered without rhythm, no tune. Distraught laughter falling over a black girl's shoulder, it's funny, it's hysterical, the melodylessness of her dance, don't tell nobody, don't tell a soul. She's dancing on beer cans and shingles. This must be the spook house. Another song with no singer's lyrics, no voices and interrupted solos, unseen performances. Are we children of horror? Ghouls? The joke? Don't tell nobody. Don't tell a soul. Are we animals? Have we gone crazy? I can't hear anything but the maddening screams and the soft strains of death, and you promised me! You promised me somebody! Anybody sing a black girl's song, bring her out to know herself, to know you. But sing her rhythms, carrying struggle, hard times, sing her songs of life. She's been dead so long, closed in silence so long, she doesn't know the sound of her own voice. Her infinite beauty, she's half notes scattered without rhythm, no tune. Sing her sighs. Sing the songs of her possibility. Sing her a righteous gospel. Let her be born. Let her be born and handled warmly. I'm outside Chicago.
I'm outside Detroit.
I'm outside Houston.
I'm outside of Baltimore.
I'm outside of San Francisco.
I'm outside Manhattan.
I'm outside St. Louis.
And this is for colored girls who have considered suicide but moved to the ends of their own rainbows.
Woo! Mama's little baby likes short hair, short hair. Mama's little baby likes short hair, red. Mama's little baby likes short hair, short hair. Mama's little baby likes short hair, red. Little Sally Walker sitting in the saucer. Rise, Sally, rise. Wipe your weeping eyes. Put your hand on your hip and let your backbone slip. Oh, shake it to the east. Oh,
Bobby was my sweetheart's alternately since the 7th grade.
and everybody always knew I started crying if somebody actually tried to take advantage of me. At Jackie's, Elena Mace was sticking her mouth all out while we tumbled out the Buick. Eddie Jones was her licking stick. But I knew how to dance. It was so hot that Terrell spewed all the punch, and Harley jumped all into Eagle's face because he was in for the Navy in the morning. Had a kick ass, so we all remember how bad he was. It seems like Sheila and Margaret was afraid to get their hair turned back, so they laid up against the wall looking almost sexy. Didn't want to sweat. But me and my fellas, we was dancing.
Okay. Since 1963, I won all kinds of contests with the cousins at the police athletic league dances. All Mercer County youth, any kind of modern dates could turn somersaults, or Smokey Robinson could get a woman excited. Mm-hmm. We danced doing nasty old tricks.
I caught this attitude I see Rosa doing. wouldn't be bothered. I was twirling, pimping, giving much quick feet, and being a cute new color Puerto Rican. Till Saturday afternoon when the dish jockey said, "Sorry folks, Willie Colon ain't gonna make it today." And all of my negativity came out of control. And I wouldn't dance with nobody, and I talked English loud, and I loved you more than I was mad. More than when I discovered Archie Shepard's sort of blues. Don't you know I wore out the magic of juju, heroically resisting being possessed. Who the sounds? Sneaking in underage as slugs to stay out of real Archie's? And every word out of your mama's mouth is gospel. And if Jesus couldn't play the horn like Shep, wasn't no need for colored folks to bend across at all. And poem is my thank you for music. And I love you more than poem. More than Ari Yolanda when dia loves Macabre. More than Hector Lavoe loves himself. More than the lady loves gardenias. More than Celia loves Cuba. More than the flamingos, shoo, and do I love being pretty? Oye, negro, te amo más que. Te amo más que when you play your flute.
Te amo más que. Te amo más que.
Or guidance from you, I have loved you assiduously for 8 months, 2 weeks, and a day. I have been stood up 4 times. I've left 7 packages on your doorstep, 40 poems, 2 plants, and 3 handmade note cards. See, I left town to send for you. Have been no help to me on my job. See, you call at 3 o'clock in the morning on weekdays so I can drive 27 and a half miles across the bay before I go to work. Charming, charming. But you are no assistant. And I want you to know that this was an experiment to see how selfish I could be. If I would really carry on to snare a possible lover. If I was capable of debasing myself for the love of another. If I could stand not being wanted when I wanted to be wanted. And I cannot. So without any further assistance and no guidance from you, I'm ending this affair. This note is attached to a plant I've been watering since the day I met you. You may want to share.
Who writes in English? Come and share the world with you.
Come and share.
hard to press charges against. If you knew him, you must have warned him.
A misunderstanding.
You know these things happen.
Are you sure you didn't suggest?
Had you been drinking?
A rapist is always to be a stranger, to be legitimate. Someone you never saw, a man with obvious problems.
Pinups attached to the insides of his apparel.
Ticket stubs from porno flicks in his pocket.
A little dick.
Or a strong mother.
Or just a brutal virgin.
But if you've been seen in public with him, dance one dance, kiss him goodbye lightly.
With closed mouth.
Pressing charges will be as hard as keeping your legs closed while five fools try to run a train on you.
And these men friends of ours who smile nice, stay employed, and take us out to dinner.
Lock the door behind you.
With this invasive fuck,
who make elaborate Mediterranean dinners and let the art ensemble carry all ethical burdens while they invite a couple of friends over to have you. I suffer from latent rapist bravado, and we are left with the scars.
Being betrayed by men who know us.
And expect, like the strangers we always thought was coming,
that we will submit.
We must have known.
Women relinquish all personal rights in the presence of a man who apparently could be considered a rapist.
Especially if he is considered
a rapist. And there's no less worthy than being beat within an inch of his life. Being published and ridiculed, having two fists shoved up his ass.
And the stranger we always thought it would be.
Who never showed up.
Because it turns out the nature of rape has changed.
We can now meet them in circles we frequent for companionship.
We see them at the coffee house.
With someone else we know.
We could even have them all for dinner and get raped in our own houses. By invitation of Fred.
Aye.
Mice.
Womb.
Nobody.
Tables. Whitewashed windows. Grime from age wiped over once. Legs spread. Anxious. Ice crawling up on me. Eyes rolling through my eye. Metal fork. Gnawing at my own. Dead mice fall from my mouth. Once I was pregnant and ashamed of myself.
quadroon bars. Elegance in St. Louis. Lace mulattoes gambling down in Mississippi to Memphis. New Orleans and upper crepes near the bayou, where the poor white trash was singing moaning strange little tones. So Cheetah had heard these things. She moved as if she had known them. Silver and high tone laughing, the violins and the marble floors. So Cheetah pushed through the clinging delta dust with painted toes. Patchwork tint was polka dotted, stale light snatched at the shadows. Creole Carnival was playing Natchez in 10 minutes. And her splendid red garden. Gin stained and itchy at the thigh. Black diamond stockings darned with yellow thread. Old starched hat the can-can fell abundantly orange round the splintering chair. Said Cheetah, Egyptian goddess of creativity, second millennium, threw her hair in a heavy coil over her neck. Said Cheetah, goddess, a recording of history. Spread crimson oil on her cheeks, waxed her eyebrows, and unconsciously slugged the last hard whiskey in glass. Mm. The broken mirror she used to decorate her face made her forehead tilt backwards. Her cheeks appear sunken, her sassy chin only large enough to her full lower lip from growing into her neck. So Cheetah had learned to make allowances for the distortions, but the heavy dust of the Delta left a tinge of grit and darkness on each one of her dresses, on her arms and her shoulders. So Cheetah was anxious to get back to St. Louis. At least in St. Louis, the grime was store-bought, secondhand. Here in Natchez, God seemed to be wiping his feet in her face. One of the wrestlers was supposed to win tonight. He was supposed to hold a booming half-cast Sierra Eagle in a bear hug, get thrown in the wet, fall out the ring, and then do the Sierra Eagle in for good. So Cheetah could hear the redneck hoofs and the pats on the back. And she gathered her sparsely sequined skirt, tugged her weight cincher from her graying slips, and made her face immobile. She made her face like Nefertiti approaching her own tomb. And she suddenly threw her leg full force through the canvas curtain. A deceptive glass stone sparkled malignant, her calf taunting the brazen carnival lights. Full moon, Cheetah, goddess love, performing the rites, the conjuring of men, conjuring the spirit. Cheetah. Root ferociously through the crack of night. Gold pieces hid in the makeshift stage her thighs. They were aiming coins through her thighs to Cheetah! Goddess, love, kicked viciously through the night, catching stars between her toes.
The library was right down from the trolley tracks, crossing the laundromat through big, shining floors and granite pillars old St. Louis was famous for. That down to some, but not until months of Cage and Katie, Pippi Longstockings, Christopher Robin, Eddie Haywood, and a Pooh Bear. In the children's room, nothing but Pioneer Girls, Magic Rabbits, and Big City White Boys. I knew I wasn't supposed to, but I ran into the adult reading room, and that's where I came across Toussaint, my first black man. I never counted George Washington Carver because I didn't like peanuts. Toussaint was a black man, a Negro, like my mama said, who refused to be a slave. And he spoke French and didn't allow no white folks to tell him nothing. Not Napoleon, not Maximilian, not Robespierre. Toussaint Louverture was the beginning of reality for me. In a summer contest for Who Colored Child Could Read 15 Books in 3 Weeks, I won and raved about Toussaint Louverture. At the afternoon ceremony, was disqualified because Toussaint belonged in the adult reading room. And I cried and carried dead Toussaint home in the book. He was dead and living to me. Because Toussaint and them, they held the citadel against the French, with the spirits of old dead Africans from out of the ground to stop led an army of zombies, walking cannonballs, shooting spirits to free Haiti. And they wasn't slaves no more. Toussaint Louverture became my secret lover at the age 8. I would detain him in my bedroom, with a flashlight under covers way into the night. We would discuss strategies, how to move white girls from my hopscotch canes, and etc. Toussaint was laying in bed with me next to Raggedy Ann the night I decided to run away from my integrated home, integrated streets, integrated school. 1955 was not a good year for little black girls. Toussaint said, let's go to Haiti. And I said, all right. And I packed some very important things in a brown paper bag so I wouldn't have to come back. Then Toussaint and I took the Hottamont streetcar to the river. Last stop, only 15 cents, because nobody could see Toussaint set me. And I walked all down through North St. Louis, where the French settlers used to live, tiny brick houses all huddled together, with barely missing windows and shingles uneven, with colored kids playing and women on no porch just sipping beer. I could talk to Toussaint like, this is where we was gonna stow away, on a boat to New Orleans and catch a Creole fishing rig to Port-au-Prince. Then we was just gonna read and talk all the time and eat fried bananas. We were just walking and skipping past old drunk men when this old young boy jumped out at me yelling, hey girl! Want to come over here and talk to me? I turned to Toussaint, who was furious, and I said, you silly old boy, you better leave me alone or Toussaint's gonna get your ass. The silly old boy came round the corner laughing all in my face. Yellow gal, you sure must be somebody to know my name so quick. I was disgusted and wanted to get out of Haiti without some tacky old boy bothering me. Still, he kept standing there, kicking milk cartons and bits of brick, trying to get all in my business. I mumbled to Louverture, what should I do? Finally, I asked, well, who are you? He said, I'm Toussaint Jones. I looked right at him, those skidded out corduroy pants, a striped t-shirt with holes in both elbows, a new scar over his left eye, and I said, what's your name again? He said, I'm Toussaint Jones. Wow. I want mama to see Toussaint Louverture in Haiti. Are you any kin to him? He don't take no stuff from no white folks, and they got a country all on their own, and there ain't no slaves. The silly old boy squinted his face all up. He said, look here, girl. My name is Toussaint Jones, and I'm right here looking at you. And I don't take no stuff from no white folks. You don't see none around here, do you? And he sort of puffed out his chest, and he said, come on, let's go down to the docks and look at the boats. I was real puzzled going down to the docks with my paper bag and my books. And I sort of felt too something of a tear leave me. And I was sad till I realized Toussaint Jones wasn't too different from Toussaint Louverture, except for the old one was back in Haiti, and this one was with me speaking English and eating apples. Yeah, Toussaint Jones is all right with me. Now tell me what all spirits we can move down by the river, St. Louis, 1955.
Hey, wait!
Orange blossoms and aqua sequins, ensconced between slight bosoms. Silk roses darted from behind her ear, the passion flower of southwest Los Angeles, meandered down Hoover Street. Past dark shuttered houses where women from Louisiana shelled peas around 3 o'clock, and sent their sons whistling to the stove for fat back and black eyed peas. She glittered and heaped, and seemed to be looking for rides when she wasn't. And absolutely eyed every man who wasn't lame, white, or nodding out. She let her thighs slip from her skirt. She slowed to be examined, and never looked back to smile or acknowledge a sincere, hey mama, or to meet the eyes of someone finding something to do in her direction. She was sullen, and the rhinestones etched in the corners of her mouth suggested tears, fresh kisses that had done no good. She always wore her stomach out, lying with small iridescent feathers, and the hairs around her navel seemed to dance, and she didn't let on. She knew from behind her waist was aching to behold the pastel ivy drawn on her shoulders to be brushed with lips and fingers smelling of honey and jardins. She was hot, a deliberate coquette who never did without what she wanted, and she wanted to be a member. She wanted to be a womb to every man arrogant enough to want her. She was the wrath of women in windows, finger in shades, old lace curtains, camouflage and despair, stretch marks. So she glittered honestly, delighted she was desired, and allowed those especially scheming, tactful suitors to experience her body and spirit tearing, so easily blending with theirs. And they were so happy, and lay on her lime sheets full and wet from her tongue. She kissed them reverently, even ankles, edges of beards. At 4:30 a.m., she rose, moving the arms and legs that trapped her. She sighed, affirming the sculptured man and made herself a bath of dark musk oil, Egyptian crystals, and Florida water to remove his smell, to wash away the glitter, to watch the butterflies melt into the suds and the rhinestones fall beneath her buttocks like smooth pebbles in a Missouri creek. Laying in the water, she became herself. Ordinary, brown braided woman with big legs and full lips. Regular. Seriously intending on finishing her night's work, she quickly walked over to her guest, straddled on her pillows, and began. You got to go now. I've got a lot of work to do, and I can't with the man around. Here in your pants, this coffee on the stove has been very nice, but I can't see you again. You got what you came for, didn't you? And she smiled. He would either mumble curses about crazy bitch or sit dumbfounded while she repeated, I couldn't possibly wake up to a strange man in my bed. Why don't you go home? She could have been slapped or verbally challenged, but she never was. And the ones that fell prey to the dazzle of hips painted with orange blossoms and magnolia-scented wrists had wanted no more than to lay between her sparkling thighs. And I planned on leaving before dawn. And she had been so divine, devastatingly bizarre, the way her mouth fit round. And now she stood, a regular colored girl, full of the same malice and livid indifference as a sister, would-be supporting a would-be home player, awaiting by the window. And they knew, and left in a hurry. She would gather her tinsels and jewels from the tub, laugh gaily or vengefully. She stored her silk roses by her bed, and when she finished writing the account of her exploit in a diary, embroidered with lilies and moonstones, she placed the rose behind her ear and cried herself to sleep.
used to live in a world. And then I moved to Harlem. Now my universe is 6 blocks. I imagine waters ancient from Accra, Tunis feeding me and cleansing me. Now my ankles are coated with gray filth from the puddling fire hydrant. My oceans were life. What waters I have here sit stagnant, circling old men's bodies, shit and broken little whiskey bottles left to make me bleed. I used to live in a world. Now I live in Harlem and my universe is 6 blocks. A tunnel with a train I can ride anywhere, remaining a stranger.
No man, you can't go with me.
I don't even know you. Not only kiss you, I'm 12 years old. Please, please, please leave me alone.
Tomorrow?
Yeah. No. I can't use it. I can stay alone. A woman in the world, and then I move to Harlem. I come in at dusk, stay close to the curb, around midnight. Pray no young man think I'm pretty in a dark morning. No, not at all. Wouldn't be good to have a tall, short, black, brown young man full of his power in the dark. And my universe is 6 blocks, straight up brick walls, women hanging out of windows like also stockings. Cats crying, children giggling, a tavern with red curtains, bad smells. Kissing ladies, smiling, and dirt sidewalks spitting. Men cursing, playing. I spent more money yesterday than the day before. This morning, nigga, I got a hole too. Hey. Hey! Hey! Come over here, bitch! Can't you see I got this $5?
Never mind, sister.
Don't pay him no mind. Go, 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 sister. Do your thing, never mind. I used to live in the world, really, the end of the world, see free and sweet talking. Come on in. Thank you. And nice day. I can't now. I can't be nice to nobody. Nice is such a ripoff. A smile and a beauty in the street is a setup. I used to be in the world. I really was in the world. I had a right to the world. And then I moved to Harlem for the setup. 6 blocks of cruelty piled up on itself. A tunnel closing.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then
Mary's nothing to say. She said, I want to tell you, he's been after me all the time, says he's free and can explain what's happening with you is nothing to me. And I don't want to hurt you, but you know I need somebody now. And you know how wonderful he is. Her friend couldn't speak or cry. They hugged and went to where he was. Put another one. He said goodbye to one, told the other he would call. He smiled at her. She held her head on her lap, the lap of sisters soaking up tears, each understanding how much love between them. Love between them. Love like sisters.
Ever since I realized there was someone called a colored girl, an evil woman, a bitch, or an egg, I've been trying not to be that. Then leave bitterness in somebody else's cup. Come to somebody to love me. Without deep or nasty smelling scar from lie, or being left screaming in the street full of lunatics, whispering slut, bitch, bitch, nigga, get out of here with all of that. I didn't have any of that for you. I gave you what joy I found when I found joy. Honest fingers around my face from dead musicians on 78s from Cuba, or live musicians on $5 LPs from Chicago, where I have never been. And I love Willie Colon and Arsenio Rodriguez because I can play the music loud enough so there is no me but dance. Mm. And when I can dance like that, there's nothing can hurt me. But I get tired. And I have to come off the floor. And then there's that woman that hurt you, who you left 3 or 4 times and just went back after you put my heart in the bottom of your shoe. Just went back to where you hurt. And I didn't have nothing. So I went to where somebody had something for me. But he wasn't you. And I was on the way back from her house in the bottom of your shoe. So this is not a love poem, because there are only memorial albums available. And even Charlie Mingus wanted desperately to be a pimp. And I won't be able to see Eddie Palmieri for months. So this is a requiem for myself, because I have died in a real way. Not with aqua coffins and doo-wop Cadillacs I used to joke about when I was messing around, but a real dead loving is here for you now, because I don't know anymore. How to avoid my own face wet with my tears, because I had convinced myself. The color girl had no right to sorrow, and I lived and I loved that way and left sorrow on the curb. Allegedly for you, but I know I did it for myself. I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand being sorry and colored at the same time. So redundant in the modern world. I live with myths, and music is my old man. I could dance, dance at a time, dance with no partners, take my pills and keep right on stepping. Linger in non-English speaking arms so there was no possibility for understanding in you. You came in saying, I'm the lady. I'm the baddest motherfucker out there, and I said, yes. This is who I'm waiting for. And to come with you, I had to everything. The dance and the tear, the dead musicians and the hope. And those scars I had hidden with smiles and good fucking lay open. And I don't know. I don't know any more tricks. I am really colored. And really sad sometimes. And you hurt me. More than
than I ever danced out of into oblivion isn't far enough to get out of this. I wanna die like the lily in the desert, and I couldn't let you in on it because I didn't know. Here is what I have. Poems, big thighs, little bits, and so much love. You take it from me this one time? Please, please, this is for you. Arsenio's trace cleared the way and makes me pure again. Please, please, I want you to love me. Let me love you. I don't want to dance with ghosts. Snuggle lovers I made up in my drunkenness. I want to love you just like I am. I'm finally being real. No longer symmetrical and impervious to pain.
Emotion too much. So, let's go on and be white then. And make everything dry and abstract with no rhythm and no really for sensual pleasure. Yes. Let's go on and be white then. We're right in the middle of it. No use holding out, holding on to ourselves. Let's think our way out of feeling. Let's abstract ourselves from families. And maybe tonight, I'll find a way to make myself come without you. No fingers or other objects, just thought, which isn't spiritual evolution because it's empty and godliness is plenty, is ripe and fertile. Thinking won't do me a bit of good tonight. I need to be loved, and haven't the audacity to say, where are you? And don't know who to say it to.
I've lost it. Touch with reality. I don't know who's doing it. I thought I was. But I was so stupid I was able to be hurt. And that's not real. Not anymore. I should be immune if I'm still alive. And that's what I was discussing. How I'm still alive and my dependency on other living beings for love. I survive on intimacy and tomorrow. And it was all I had going, and the music like smack, and you knew about that and still refused. My dance was not enough. And it was all I had with being alive and being a woman and being colored is a metaphysical dilemma I haven't conquered yet. Do you see the point? My spirit is too ancient to understand the separation of soul and gender. My love is too delicate to have thrown back on my things. My love is too delicate to have thrown back on my things.
My love is too beautiful to have thrown back on my face.
My love is too sanctified to have thrown back on my face.
My love is too magic to have thrown back on my face.
My love is too Saturday night to have thrown back on my face.
My love is too complicated to have thrown back on my face. My love is too music to have thrown back on my face.
Music.
Somebody
but somebody almost walked off with all my stuff. Like a kleptomaniac working hard on forgetting while stealing. This is mine. This ain't your stuff. Now why won't you put me back and let me hang out in my own stuff? Somebody almost walked off with all my stuff and didn't care enough to sit and know what I'm saying. I was late for my solo conversation, or two sizes too small for my own tax skirt. What can somebody do with no value on the open market? Did you get a dime off any of my things? Hey man, where are you going with all my stuff? This is a woman's trip and I need my things to ooh and ah about. Daddy, I gotta make my number for my own shit. Now why won't you put me back and let me play this duet? With the silver ring in my nose, honest to God, somebody almost run off with all my stuff. And I didn't bring anything but the kick and sway of it, the perfect ass for my man, and none of it is theirs. This is mine. Rainy, her own things, that's my name. Now give me my stuff. I see you hiding my laugh, and how I sit with my legs open sometimes to give my crotch some sunlight. And there goes my love. My toes, my chewed up fingernails. Nigga with the curls in your head. Mr. Louisiana Hot Link. I want my things back. My rhythm in my voice. Open my mouth and let me talk you out of throwing my shit in the sewer. This is some delicate leg and whimsical kissing. I gotta have to get to my choice without you running off with all my shit. Now you can't have me unless I give you away.
Hello.
And I was doing all that. To you run off on such a good thing. And who was this you left me with? Some simple bitch with a bad attitude. I want my things. I want my arm with the hot iron scar and leg with the flea bite. I want my callous feet, put language back in my mouth, fried blanches, pineapple, pear juice, summer, Joseph and Jules. I want my own things. How I lived them. And give me back my memories. How I was when I was there. You can't have or do nothing with them. Stealing my shit from me don't make it yours.
Mason stolen.
Somebody almost went off with all my stuff. And I was standing there, looking at myself the whole time. And there wasn't no spirit almost went off with all my stuff. Was a man whose ego walked around like Rodan Shadow. Was a man faster in my innocence with a lover I made too much room for almost went off with all my stuff. And I didn't know I'd give up so quick. And the one running with it, don't know he got it. And I'm shouting, this is mine! He don't know he got it. My stuff is the anonymous, ripped off treasure of the year. Do you know somebody almost got away with me, in a plastic bag under the arm. Me, dangling on a string of personal carelessness. I'm splattered with mud and city rain, and no, I didn't get a chance to take a douche. Hey man, this is not your problem. I gotta have me in my pocket to get around like a good woman should. To make a poem in the pot or a chicken in the dance. What I gotta do, I gotta have my stuff to do it. Why don't you find your own things and leave this package to me for my destiny? What you gotta give me? I'll give it to you. Yeah, I'll give it to you. Around 5 o'clock in the winter, when the sky's blue red and new cities get impressed. If it's really my stuff, you gotta give it to me. If you really want it, I'm the only one can handle it.
That nigga will be back tomorrow, saying he saw.
Get this. My old man came in yesterday saying, I don't know how she got your number, baby. I'm sorry.
No. This is the one. Oh, baby. You know I was high. I'm sorry.
I'm only human. And inadequacy is what makes us human. If I was perfect, I wouldn't have nothing to strive for. So you might as well go ahead and forgive me for today because I'm sorry.
Shut up, bitch. I told you I was sorry.
No, this is it. I only do you like I do you because I thought you could take it.
Now I know that you know that I love you, but I ain't never gonna love you the way you want me to love you. Now I'm sorry.
Oh my God.
Oh.
with them. Nope. They don't open doors or bring the sun back. They don't make me happy. Or get them on the paper. Didn't nobody stop using my tears to wash cars because of sorrow.
Hello.
I'm simply tired of collecting. I didn't know I was so important. I can't get to the clothes in my closet for all of these sorrows. What am I gonna do?
What you gonna do?
What am I gonna do?
What you gonna do?
I'm gonna tack a sign at the door.
What else?
Leave a message by the phone. If you want to say you're sorry, call somebody else. I don't need them anymore.
Don't need them.
I was sorry. Didn't mean to. Okay. And how could I know about that? Take a walk down a dark and musty street in Brooklyn. I'm gonna be happy and do what I want to when I want to, and I won't be sorry for none of you. Let sorry suit your soul, I'm gonna suit mine. You were always inconsistent. Doing something and being sorry. Beat my heart to death talking about your sorry.
Up in the bed, wrapped up in the sheets, looking like John the Baptist or a huge baby with stubble and nuts.
And now he had to get all that shit out of Crystal's mind so she would let him come home. Crystal had gone and got a court order saying that Bo Willie Brown had no access to his children. And if he showed his face, he was subject to arrest. Shit. She'd been in his ass to marry her since she was 14 years old. And here when she's 22, she want to throw him out because he said he'll marry her. She burst out laughing. Hollering. What you want to marry me for now? So I can come support your ass? Or come sit with you when they lock you behind up? Because they going to come for you, you goddamn lunatic. They going to come. And I ain't going to have a thing to do with it. Oh, no. I wouldn't marry your pitiful black ass for nothing. She went on to bed. The next day, Bo Willie came in blasting and got to swinging chairs at Crystal, who couldn't figure out what the hell he was doing till he got to shout about how he was going to marry her and give her a various benefits. He could stop burning those paintings, fixing her legs, trying to kill him for $15. Bo was beating something, sweating something terrible beating on Crystal. And he couldn't do no much more with the table and chair, so he went to get the high chair. And Kiwami was still in it. And Bo was beating up Crystal with the high chair and her son. And then some notion got into him to stop, and he run out. Crystal almost died. That's why the police didn't allow Bo near where she lived. And she'd been telling the kids that their daddy tried to kill her and Kiwami. And he just wanted to marry her. He wanted to marry her and have a family, but the bitch was crazy. Bo Willie sat up in this hotel in his drawers, drinking coffee and wine in the heat of the day, spilling shit all over himself, laughing, talking about how he was gonna get Crystal to take him back and let him be the man in the house, and she wouldn't even have to work no more. He got all dressed up in his ivory shirt and checkered pants to go see Crystal, get this mess all cleared up. He knocked on the door to Crystal's room. She didn't answer. He beat on the door, and Crystal not only started crying, and Bo just kept screaming for her to marry him, and was she always going to be a whore? Did she want a family? And Crystal just kept on screaming for him to leave us alone! Just leave us alone! So Bo broke down the door. Crystal grabbed the children and held them out in front of her. She picked Kiwami from the floor in her arms and held Naomi by her shoulders and kept on saying, Bo Willie Brown, get out of here! The police is going to come for you, fool! Get out of here! You want the children to see you act the fool again? You want Kiwami to be brain damaged from you throwing him around? Nigga, get out of here! Get out! And don't show your ass or I'll kill you! I swear I'll kill you! And he reached for Naomi. Crystal grabbed the little girl, stared at Bo Willie like he was a leper or something. Don't you touch my children, motherfucker, I'll kill you. Jump back all humble and apologetic like, I'm sorry. I don't want to hurt him, I just want to hold him and be on my way. I don't want to cause you no more trouble. I wanted to marry you, give you things. What you want to give, a broken jaw? Nigga, get out of here! He ignored Crystal's outburst and sat down motioning for Naomi to come to him. She smiled at her dad. Crystal felt Naomi giving in and held her daughter tighter. And Naomi pushed away and ran to her daddy crying, Daddy, Daddy, come back, Daddy. Come back, but be nice to Mommy, because Mommy loves you and you gotta be nice. And he sat her on his knee and played with her ribbons, and they counted fingers and toes, and ever so often he looked over to Crystal holding Kiwami like a statue, and she said, See, Crystal, I could be a good father. Now let me see my son. She didn't move. And he coaxed her and he coaxed her. Told her she was still a hot little old thing and pretty and strong. And didn't she get right back up after that little old fight they had and go on to work? Mm-hmm. Oh, Willie, ooh, it's kindness. And Crystal, who I'd known so little, but boho clung. And as soon as Crystal let the baby out of her arms, Bo jumped up a laughing and a giggling, a hooting, a hollering. Aye, bitch, you gonna marry me. You gonna marry me. I ain't gonna marry you for nothing. Now give me my kids. Give me back my kids. And he kicked the screen out of the window and helped the kids off the skill. You gonna marry me. Yeah, I'll marry anything. Just bring the children back inside the house. And he looked from where the children were hanging from the fifth story at all the people screaming at him. He was sweating. Santa
to all the neighbors. Say you're gonna marry me! I stood by Bo in the window when Naomi was reaching for me and Kiwami screaming, "Mommy! Mommy!" On the fifth story. But I could only whisper. And he dropped them.
Fine skinny.